The Philco Predicta, in my opinion, is one of the most iconic classic televisions of all time. They're easily recognizable from their modern space-age design, but despite its futuristic look, these televisions suffered a lot of problems that make finding a working one pretty much impossible. So in this video, I'm gonna address some of these issues and hopefully I can get this thing to work. This TV was built in 1959 and was known as the Debutante model of the Predicta line, aka the Danish modern model. So the first thing I noticed was a faulty power switch on the front. These used to fail, and a common result was just installing an aftermarket switch on the top. The front two knobs also control the contrast for the 17-inch CRT and volume for the single mono speaker. So we have a very generous amount of 13 channels on the tuner. It turned pretty easily, wasn't frozen or anything. This then connects up to the antenna, which would be responsible for the television's video signal. But the FCC no longer supports this kind of broadcast system. So here's what it looks like when you undo the bolts and take the chassis out of the TV. Here's the chassis number 10043, and this is what I used to find all documentation on this television. I found a listing for this TV on the Space Coast of Florida Craigslist, and when I went to go pick it up, the lady had it sitting outside near the beach under one of those Hawaiian palapa shacks. I was afraid that the ocean air and all the Florida humidity would leave this thing totally rusted. So here you can see some corrosion building up in that fusible resistor. They used to call these things fusistors. There's basically a fuse mixed with a resistor. It's so the vacuum tubes have a slow and gradual power up when the TV is switched on. Now don't get me wrong, this thing is absolutely disgusting. Here's what the IF board looked like under the shield. If it wasn't for the edges, you couldn't even tell that was a green circuit board. I wouldn't be surprised if somebody chain smoked straight into this thing for 50 years. So the high voltage rectifier tube didn't look like it was doing so well. It had a black dust on it that looked charred, and also it had a strange melted plastic at the base of it. I think it actually melted one of these red wires here, and they try to hold it away from it using this tape. I figured I'd need a new one of these, so I consulted the inside of the cabinet, and I ordered anything I didn't already have on hand. I cleaned the tube up anyways, and it looks cosmetically fine, but there's a distinct rattle, so I'm no expert, but that can't be good. So here I am at my workbench, and I took the board off from the chassis. Before I could go about replacing anything, this thing had to be cleaned from top to bottom. So here's a close-up of the board after I finished cleaning it. The transformation was practically night and day. Now I could actually start replacing all the components I needed to, like this capacitor that has this giant crack going down it. I couldn't believe that instead of replacing this resistor, they broke the old one and tacked the new one on top. Now it's tough to say if it was a repairman, but all I can say is I hope no one got paid to do this. So this isn't really wrong to do, but it's just sloppy. Somebody twisted these two resistors and just soldered them straight to the top of the board instead of finding the correct value. Another major problem these predicted televisions had were faulty tube sockets. When there's a break in the metal like this, you have to wiggle around the tube or even put weight on it for it to light up. Here you can see what the metal looks like in one of these things, and it's so thin, every time you take a tube out or put it in, you bend that. Thankfully, with the popularity of tube amps for guitars, these brand new replacement 9-pin tube sockets were readily available. With how badly these were designed, I decided just to replace all of them. So I removed all the old ones, put the new ones in, bent the leads down, and soldered them all in place. This is what Philco calls a couplet. They're just a basic network of resistors and capacitors, but they're condensed into this little thing. There are 5 of these, and unfortunately, you just have to make your own. With how they made components in the 50s versus how they make them today, this thing is going to be way more accurate in terms of efficiency than it ever was coming out of the factory. So here's what the couplets look like after I made them. They're a lot bigger than the little things I pulled out of there. A lot bigger than I'd hoped actually, but That whole built-to-last thing that people like to throw around about things made way back when in America really only applies to more mechanical things, definitely not televisions. Next up are the electrolytics, and they come in these big cans. The values are written on the side, but you really need to follow the schematic to know exactly where the wires go. There are about 3 or 4 electrolytic capacitors just crammed into one. I made sure to write down all the values that were on the cans. It was much easier to line up all the new components I bought. There were a total of 3 of these in the TV, and even though they don't necessarily have to be replaced if they're still good, I decided to just replace everything. So this one's a 3-section cap. You can see that there are 3 in the center, and then the outer edge is the ground. I was actually debating on whether or not to unstuff the old cans and put the new electrolytics in, but I decided it was best to just use the old breadboard stuff that I was using before to make the other networks, and just do it that way. You're not going to see the cans when everything's put back together, so I thought it was just too much effort. I made sure the wires had a strong physical connection so they wouldn't pull apart. Here's the new one placed in exactly where the old one was. One thing you need to be aware of in these electrolytic capacitors is their polarity, which is pretty much just the right way the current should be flowing through the component from positive to negative. Here in the schematic, you can see there are 3 electrolytic capacitors in the corner, and they have a curve that represents the negative side, and those are all facing ground. The reason why you need to be mindful when you put these in the circuit, say if you put the positive side towards ground, when you finally power on the set, the capacitor is going to blow open. In my hands are every single component I've taken out of this thing, and hopefully sorting them out like this helps a little bit. So for the resistors, we have the 0.5 watt, then 1 watt, 2 watt, including this weird one, 3 watt, and a 7 watt. So from left to right, you can see the resistors getting bigger. The 2 rows in the center are capacitors, and they used to make these out of paper and wax, and those just aren't good anymore. Nowadays, they make these components from metal film. Here's what's inside the crack from that capacitor from earlier. Some refer to these as black beauties. So as far as documentation goes, I had 3 things help me. Here's the parts list I used. And here's a map of the board that allows you to visualize exactly where the parts on the parts list go. And last but not least is the schematic, for making sure every wire is exactly where it needs to be. After all that work, here's the finished board ready to go in. Looking over it, you can see everything that was replaced, from the networks, to the tube sockets, to the resistors, to the capacitors. Really, this thing looks brand new compared to how it was when I started. It was also very useful to label these wires so they could be put back easier. Okay, I have my PlayStation 2. I have an output from a PlayStation 1 that is coaxial. It goes to a matching transformer that connects to the original antenna leads of the television, goes into the tuner, and into the rest of the TV. We have light. There's a raster. Turn the PS2 on. There's a vertical hold. And there we go! Looks like we have a pretty bright picture too. These old CRT TVs dealt with vertical and horizontal hold and linearity. Those controls are on the back, and you almost always have to adjust them. Another issue these Predictas had were overheating problems. Keep in mind that vacuum tubes get hot enough as it is, and this TV was very compact for its time. This was more prevalent with the wooden models that didn't have vents, but regardless, I think it's best that I add a fan on the back, like a PC case for circulation. Here I have an AC-DC converter, and it's the 12-volt source that I'm going to use for the fan. I'm going to solder the plug side to the AC line on the TV and the 12-volt DC side to the fan. It's kind of bulky, so in order to fit this in the TV, I'm going to have to open it up with an Allen wrench and kind of slim it down. When I plug the TV in, the fan is going to immediately come on, even if the TV is on or off, which I don't mind because I can leave it plugged in and when I turn the set off, it can just blow the hot air out. Now, I don't plan on leaving this thing plugged in 24/7, so if I can hear the fan, that's a pretty good reminder for me to get up and unplug this thing before it burns my house down. Now that I have this TV working, I plan on making future videos showing it play different things. If you have a suggestion or anything specific you'd like to see on this TV, let me know down in the comments. And before I end this video, I just want to thank other YouTube channels like Shango66, B. Anderson TV, and Mr. Carlson's Lab. I'm no electrical engineer, but I learned everything I've demonstrated in this video from those guys. If you're interested in tube electronics or restoration, definitely check them out. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for more.